hear the sound. I hear that on the inside, hear the sound. Hear the sound. And then I see a picture. I've seen it before. The mother duck, the mother goose, Canadian geese out on the lake, and the little goslings are close by, but they've wandered away. And an enemy is approaching. And somehow they understand the sound. She just makes a different kind of quack. And they scurry. And they hurry to get into the protection. And all they did was hear the sound. And we have in our troops and our armed forces, the men and women of the military trained to respond to this sound or that sound, reveille may sound, and they are brought to a action response because they hear the sound. Gather the troops ready for the fight. Taps, ready to rest, charge. Gabriel is going to blow the trumpet, and we will hear the sound. There is a sound in the spirit. And as we hear the sound and respond, those who hear it, sometimes it's to scurry, to hurry, to get into the place of refuge. The rock that's higher than I. He shows us things to come. Sometimes that's good. Sometimes it's to prepare and to warn. Attacks are coming, evil. Hear the sound. Get ready. Be prepared. Be on guard. Be vigilant for your adversary. Walketh about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Be sober. Well, that's the sound. Be sober. Be vigilant. Be prepared. Be ready. Or hear the sound. It's time for you to attack. Hear the sound. It's time for you to gather into the place of rest. Hear the sound. It's time for you to pull away and pull aside and come into the refuge of his goodness and his grace. Taps is being blown. And I'm going to the place of rest. There's a sound in the spirit for those who hear it. And I'm sitting there and I hear on the inside, hear the sound. And I had a picture of the geese on the pond, the geese on the lake, and the little goslings, the young ones. And she does some sort of a little quack, but they know what it means. And they hurry. They don't see the enemy, but she does. And she just makes a sound. Oh, when we are dull of hearing. Sometimes we don't avoid those things which should be avoided, could be avoided. God has given the sound. And there is a rock that is higher than I. That rock is the place, the cleft of the rock, you know, when the storm rages. The little young eagle in the mother's nest just has peace and safety, and the storm can rage and the billows roll. But the eaglet in the mother's nest is safe and secure in the cleft of the rock. Hear my cry, O Lord. Attend unto my prayer. From the ends of the earth will I cry out unto thee. Lead lead me to the rock. In the midst of the storm, there's safety and security in the rock. Hear the sound. I had a picture of those geese, the little young ones. And they had strayed just a little bit, just a little distance away from the mother's protection. And she just did a little bit of a quack and they scurried. I've seen that. But I've not thought of that all day long. But I just had the picture of it. Oh, just the sound provided safety. Just the sound. But they had to hear it, recognize it. And then I thought about the military. All different sounds. But they've been trained what they mean. And then they've been trained to respond. The sound brings them all to the leader, into formation. And God, Jesus Christ, is our leader. And I think about Gabriel, at that sound, we're all going to be brought into formation. We're all going to be brought and presented in the presence of our leader. But even now, we can hear the sound and come to a attention, come to a recognition. Psalm 29, verse 3 says, the voice of the Lord is upon the waters. Verse 4 says, the voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. Verse 5 says, the voice of the Lord breaketh the cedars. Verse 7 says, the voice of the Lord divideth the flames of fire. Verse 8 says, the voice of the Lord shaketh the wilderness. Verse 9 says, the voice of the Lord maketh the hinds to calve. Verse 10 says, the Lord sitteth upon the flood, yea, the Lord sitteth king forever. The Lord will give strength unto his people. The Lord will bless his people with peace. The voice of the Lord, hear the sound, and then respond. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the voice of the Lord. The voice of the Lord in my spirit. And oh, how I desire to hear it. The signification of the voice. The meaning of the voice. I remember the time where it thundered. They thought it thundered. It was the voice of the Lord. To Jesus, it was with comprehension. He understood it. Others thought it simply thundered. I want the significance that it's not a voice without any meaning. Hear his voice and understand the meaning. I listen to that little mother goose. Well, not so little, but, you know. I hear her little quack. It doesn't mean alert, alert, danger around to me. It sounds like any, you know, maybe there's a difference, you know. Maybe there's, but I don't recognize it. But they just scurry. And I look, you know, I see, well, there's a hawk flying over. Or maybe there's a dog or something that's come nearby. She saw that. She saw that hawk. And she just gives a little quack. It's not really significant to me. It's just a quack to me. But they understand it. Well, I don't want it to sound like thunder. I want to understand it. The voice of the Lord. Hear the sound. One reason, not the only reason, one reason for sin is it because it dulls our hearing. We can repent and God is merciful, but if you keep digging up a seed, you stunt its growth. You can replant it and get it to grow. If you keep digging up a potted plant, you can plant it again and it'll continue to grow, but you're hindering it. I want to be ready to minister. You know, Paul said, look at 1 Corinthians 9:27. Paul said, and you hear me refer to this on occasion, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 9:27, I keep under my body. That is, I'm the one in control. The body has desires. If Paul's body had desires that were contrary, you know yours do. Mine does. Yours does. So he said, I keep an under, but notice I bring it into subjection. Notice, though, his motivation is so I can be a blessing to others. Because if I don't, I can preach to others, but be a castaway myself. And so he's thinking about his effectiveness. I hear people say, well, they want to please God. That's important. I heard somebody recently say that he wanted to keep his own self-respect. Well, that's important too, but that's not the most important. I'm not the most important. I mean, my self-respect is important. But Paul is saying, I want to be able to minister to other people. And I'll lose my effectiveness. And then he wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 2. He said in verse 20, in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. But they're still in the house. If a man therefore purge himself, that is, he does it. People are praying to God to take things away. I remember a lady, you know, she was praying that God would take her snuff away. Lord, I don't want it. Take it. Lord, I don't want it. Take this old snuff away from me. Well, the Lord doesn't want it either. What's he going to do with it if he took it? The Lord doesn't dip snuff. I'm just asking for him to take this away from me. He's not interested in taking it. But it does say for you to do something about it. And how does that tie in? Well, he wants us to hear his voice and also to stay prepared. It's not for my benefit only. It does benefit me. Don't misunderstand. And I pray, I preach grace. I preach mercy. And I preach, you know, we were talking earlier today about the difference between the puppy dog and the lion. The lion and the puppy dog. Feed the puppy dog, it'll get strong. Starve the lion, it'll get weak. A brand new baby Christian, you know, is sort of similar to the puppy dog and the lion. The puppy dog on the inside is alive, all right, but the lion is like the flesh that still controls different aspects of that person's life. But as you grow, feed the puppy dog will get strong. Starve the lion will get weak. One reason for fasting, not the only reason, but one reason is it teaches the body your boss. And then feed the spirit. Don't just fast. Don't just starve the lion, but feed the puppy dog. Romans chapter 8 says that we overcome we mortify the deeds of the body. Put to death. Mortify means put to death through the spirit. Well, why do we do that? Well, it's to please God. It's for self-respect. You're going to be upset with yourself. But I want to encourage people, quit kicking yourself. You know, get out from under that condemnation. Quit kicking yourself and receive forgiveness and mercy and grace. But that doesn't mean you just go right back into it, because after all, God will forgive you again. I'll just ask him to forgive me. My flesh wants it, so I'll do it. It dulls our spiritual senses. And the devil knows that. And then we lose some of our effectiveness. Well, I don't want to be a vessel of dishonor. I've made mistakes, sinned, shortcomings, just like anyone else. Nobody's perfect here. You know what I mean by that? Spiritually, that might be one thing, but Paul said, I've not already attained. He said in Philippians chapter 3, I'm not already perfect. That means he's not completely, fully spiritually mature. He said that in Philippians chapter 3. But in verse 21, 2 Timothy 2:21, if a man therefore purge himself from these, he'll be a vessel of honor. So you're in the house, you're saved. Somebody said, well, he sinned, he's not even saved. Paul disagrees. Well, he sinned, so he's lost his salvation. If he died right now, he'd go to hell. Paul disagrees. He's still in the house. Now, sin, James said, sin when it's finished brings forth death, but it hasn't finished yet. That's really the design. The devil wants it to finish. But it does speak of a vessel of dishonor. Purge from these, you'll be a vessel of honor. Sanctified, that means set apart for the master's use. Meet means prepared or fitting or suitable. And then it goes on to say, prepared unto every good work. And so, you know, if your flesh is tempted to do one thing or another that your heart knows wrong, then you can imagine it. While I'm in that, doing my own thing, what if danger's coming and I'm not even hearing? I'm not able to hear it. It'll dull my senses. If those little goslings got too far away from Mother Goose, they wouldn't even hear that little quack. Be too far away to hear it, or be too far away to get to the protection. Well, I hear it, but whoops, there's the hawk. And so it's good to stay close. And then, what if you have the opportunity to minister to someone? Well, you're not prepared. So I, even though we preach grace and mercy, we were talking some today about some of these things. We preach grace, we preach mercy, we preach, you know, some people come to church Sunday morning, but they know what they did Saturday night. And we were talking today about, I was in a service one time where we were worshiping God. I was trying to. I'm at the keyboard playing and singing, and it was just like there was a cloud in the place. And I just stopped. Right in mid-song. I mean, I was in the middle of the song, and I just stopped. Stopped the music, stopped the singing, and I said, what's it going to take for all of you to start to worship God? How long are you going to have to live holy before you believe you are? Because I knew some of them were feeling condemned about what they had done last night. And they feel, I can't worship God because I'm remembering what I did. Well, you've got to get rid of that if you're sincere. And go ahead and don't kick yourself, but don't keep feeding that lion. Starve the lion. You feed the lion, he'll have some strength. And that's what Peter said, be sober, be vigilant, because you've got an adversary walking about as a roaring lion. And so I said to the people, you know, that they've repented, they've asked the Lord to forgive them, but they're still kicking themselves about what they're remembering they did. And so I said, how long are you going to have to live holy? Another few hours? Do you have to go 3 days without doing anything wrong before you figure out you're righteous? Maybe a week. I went a whole week without sinning. So now I can worship God. Isn't that self-righteousness? Isn't it? Just self-righteousness. I'm righteous because of what I did. Look at Titus chapter 3, verse 5. It's not by works of righteousness which we've done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. By the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. Now the next verse, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior. So it's not because of what I did, it's because of what he did. And so I asked that church, I mean, maybe not every individual, but it was enough that it affected all of us cloud in the place. How long are you going to have to live without sin, holy, before you believe you're right with God enough to where you can worship him? And they got it. Well, I went back to the keyboard. I think I got up and actually walked away from the keyboard. But I went back to playing and singing, and it just changed in an instant. I mean, the cloud lifted and we were worshiping God. And so I preach that and teach that, encourage people. Just put faith in the blood. That's what Paul wrote to the Romans. He said, your righteousness is by faith in the blood. It's not by faith in your own good deeds. Or you've lived good, you know, for the last 2 or 3 days or a week or so. And so you must be right with God because you're so holy. No, it's faith in the blood. It's faith in him. But it is important that I walk in the light as he's in the light. That's what 1 John 1:7 says. It's important that I stay in fellowship. And if I'm not, then I need to change that quick and repent quick and get back in fellowship. Let the blood of Jesus wash away all sin and make sure that I'm in close fellowship, because I want to hear the voice. I want to hear the sound. I want to hear there's people in Winston-Salem tonight that are talking. I'm not hearing a one of them. But if I'd get in the car and drive that direction, and then I got to where they were, then I can hear them. You will hear better when you're closer. And then we can be in a crowd and you hear a lot of voices, a lot of talking and clamor, and maybe we'll be at a convention, or we'll be at a large complex. Maybe it's a shopping center or it's a big store or something, and a lot of people, and there's a lot of different sounds and people talking, and you just hear that. You know, maybe in a busy restaurant, and Susan's gone somewhere, or I've gone somewhere, and we've, you know, gone our different directions for just the moment, and then I'll hear her just call my name. Maybe not even my name. She might say, honey. Well, anybody could be calling somebody else honey. But I recognize her voice. I recognize her voice. And I don't respond to just anybody saying honey, but I recognize her voice. Well, we need to recognize his voice. Some people hear birds. Other people hear cardinals and blue jays. Some people smell flowers. Other people smell roses and carnations. There's a distinguishing difference. And if you know the attributes, then you can distinguish the difference. I want to know his voice. And the voice of a stranger I'm not going to follow. And I want to be close enough to hear his voice and not be dull of hearing. Be sensitive to hear the sound. To hear the sound. Hear the sound of protection. Hear the sound of the call to assembly. Hear the sound of the call to arms. Hear the sound of the call to rest. I want to be led of the Spirit and hear the sound and hear the voice. Be sensitive to hear it. Not be dull. Iron sharpeneth iron. You know, coming to services like this, I encourage people, don't ever feel condemned about what you did Saturday. The devil's ball game is to get you so condemned. Well, I'm not even going to go to church. I feel like a hypocrite. No, don't play his game. All the hypocrites ought to come to church. That's where we want all those hypocrites. We want them in church. And the people who have missed the mark and done wrong. But Paul, he said, the reason I keep under my body is because I don't want to be a castaway when I'm preaching to others. He put the emphasis on the others. And then he said to Timothy, the reason that I want you to purge yourself is so that you will be prepared unto every good work. And we need to realize the devil's ball game. Now, the temptation of the flesh, it's real, and that it has pleasure, and I can get forgiveness later. And there is mercy and there is grace. But I don't want to miss the opportunity of hearing his sound. I don't want to miss the opportunity of being fully prepared unto every good work. I don't want to miss that. I don't want to miss that. I don't want to miss the opportunity of hearing his sound. And the call to assembly, the call to arms, the call to formation, the call to rest. Hear the sound. Stay prepared to hear the sound. Hear the sound and stay prepared to hear the sound. Well, Paul also said to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 8, and you can find Romans chapter 14, and you can also find 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4 and Romans chapter 14. And let's look first of all at 1 Corinthians chapter 8. Well, also Colossians chapter 2. I'm hearing the inside of me. I don't have any of this prepared. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8, he said in verse 1, as touching things offered to idols, well, we all have knowledge, but knowledge puffs up. Make sure you're doing what you're doing based on love. You can get puffed up by knowing you're doing it right. Or you're believing or you're thinking, according to your knowledge, you're doing what you have been taught that's right. You can get all puffed up because you're so good. But it's the love of God in you that edifies. If any man think that he knows anything, he knows nothing that he ought to know. But if any man love God, the same is known of him. As concerning, therefore, the eating of those things that are offered in sacrifice unto idols, well, the idol's nothing. There's not any other God except one. And then he comes down to verse 8. We don't want to read the whole chapter. Well, we could. It would be good. Well, verse 7, he speaks of the conscience. And the conscience of the weak being defiled. And then verse 8, he said the meat itself, whether you eat it or you don't eat it, doesn't bring you any commendation with God. You're not commended. God's not pleased one way or the other. However, he goes on to say, we're not better or worse, whether we do or we don't. And yet people feel self-righteous because they obeyed the letter of the law like they've been taught all their lives. And yet Paul is saying, I'm just going to tell you about it. You feel all puffed up over the knowledge that you've got. I know I'm not talking to anybody here, but I'm talking about people you know. He said, you may have a lot of knowledge, but I want you to have love that'll edify. And if you've got that, the love of God, then that's the same. That's what's known. And the meat, verse 8, doesn't make us any better or any worse whether we eat it or don't eat it. But verse 9, don't let your liberty be a stumbling block. So again, he's putting emphasis on other people, isn't he? Now come over into Romans chapter 14. So when I say hear the voice, hear the sound, and be close and be ready and prepared, I don't mean the letter of the law. I don't mean rules and regulations. I don't mean in obeying some man's creed of conduct. Well, I fit the bill because I'm doing what they say to do. I must be ready. No, you can have a sense of self-righteousness that doesn't bring any commendation from God. God doesn't care one way or the other. You're not better or worse. Come on now. That's what he just said. And then in Romans chapter 14, he said in verse 17, let's back up. Verse 14. Actually, this whole chapter is good. Come back up to verse 1. We won't read every verse, but we could. It'd be good. Verse 1, those that are weak into faith, go ahead and receive, but not to doubtful disputations. One believes that he can eat anything. Another, who's weak in faith, the knowledge of the New Testament. You see, he's writing to people that were still aware of the Old Testament. And yet people today, they ought to know better, but they're still aware of the Old Testament. The book of Hebrews says that which waxeth old is ready to vanish away. Isn't that right? Hebrews, the book of Hebrews says that which waxeth old is ready to vanish away. God's given us a new covenant established upon better, a better covenant established upon better promises. In that he calleth one old and the other new means the one that's old is waxed old and ready to vanish away. He's fulfilled it. It's still for our admonition and we can read and learn, but the word, the Old Testament's been fulfilled. In fact, all of the Old Testament law is fulfilled in one word, namely this, thou shalt love. If we'd walk in love, we're automatically going to keep the Ten Commandments. I don't have to keep the Ten Commandments if I keep the commandment of love. I'm not going to steal from somebody if I love them. Come on. Amen. And so people who are weak in the knowledge of the New Testament, and you've got a lot of that today, still today. It was more in that day because this is early in the Christian life and Christian walk. This is the foundation. But you've got a lot of people today that really are not New Testament taught. They're religiously brainwashed. So he says, some people say you can eat anything. Other people who are weak in the knowledge of the New Testament don't want to eat meat. And the reason is 1 Corinthians chapter 8. They don't want to eat if it's been off. It could, maybe that's been offered to an idol. Better not eat it. And then you've got people that call one day, you know, verse 5. They esteem one day above another. Another says every day's alike. Verse 5. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. He that regardeth it, and he does it to the Lord. And he that regardeth it not, it's to the Lord that he doth and regard it. And the eating of meat, it's to the Lord. Whether he eats it or doesn't eat it, it's to the Lord. Verse 7, none of us liveth to himself. No man dieth. It's whether we live, it's to the Lord. Or whether we die, it's to the Lord. And so verse 10, you don't need to be judging your brother. You're just doing good if you're judging yourself. In these areas, you see, it's talking about these areas. Verse 13, then let us not, therefore, not judge one another in these areas, but judge this, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. That's what he just said in 1 Corinthians 8. Now, verse 14 is a really powerful verse. So when I say hear the voice, when I say stay prepared and stay ready and stay close, I'm not talking about somebody's creed of conduct and rules and regulations and the outward appearance and you've got every jot and tittle of the flesh taken care of and I'm looking the part and everybody must see that I'm holy. No, I'm talking about being close to him according to the word and by the spirit. Verse 14 is a really powerful verse. I know and am persuaded by the Lord Jesus Christ that there is nothing unclean of itself. Nothing is unclean of itself. Nothing is unclean of itself. In fact, why don't you hold your place there? How many fingers do you have anyway? Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 12. All things are lawful unto me. There's nothing unclean of itself. It's all lawful to me. Is that what it says? But he says it's not expedient or profitable. If it's not, now remember what I believe Paul wrote Hebrews. Remember what he said to the Hebrews? Lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. Let us run the race that is set before us with patience. Somebody says, well, that's not a sin. And they want to argue because they sure want to keep doing it. Most of the time when people are arguing about something not being a sin, it's because they want to do it. They're doing it. Well, it's not a sin to drink. Well, you drink, don't you? Well, you know, occasionally. It's not a sin to smoke. You smoke, don't you? Well, you know. Well, is it a weight? Is it a weight? You don't run a race with a pocket full of weights. You want to lay those weights down. You're ready for the race. Is it hindering your walk with God? Is it hindering your testimony? Is it hindering your hearing his voice? Is it hindering your being prepared? Now, we want to preach grace and mercy, and we want to preach to the carnal Christians and the baby Christians and the hypocrite Christians to repent and come to. Don't ever stay away from church because you feel bad about something you did. No, that's the devil's game. Come to church and hear and get right. Somebody say amen. Well, all things are lawful, but it's not profitable. It may not be a sin, but is it a weight? Is it hindering me? Then I need to lay it aside. It may be lawful, all right, but it's not expedient. Verse 12 now, 1 Corinthians 6, 12. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. And then he talks about the flesh, meats for the belly for meats. He's talking about the flesh. And then God shall destroy both it and them. He talks about the body. So the body has this desire, but I want to control it. Well, it's not a sin. I know it, but I'm not going to let it control me. Can I have an amen, somebody? Amen. I'm not going to let it control me. Most of the time, people who smoke, it's controlling them. Well, it's not a sin. Is it controlling you? And it'll hurt your heart. It may not be a sin. It may be lawful, all right, but is it profitable? Is it expedient? Is it controlling you? Look at 1 Corinthians 10. Is this all right tonight? I'm just sort of following the flow. I didn't have this prepared. I had something else ready. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 23. Paul is saying, all things are lawful for me. That's why it bothers me when I hear people preach the letter of the law. This is how you've got to look. This is what you've got to wear. You can't eat that. That's a sin. No, all things are lawful. We've got the law of love. And then Paul said, I don't want my brother to be offended or grieved. I don't want to put a stumbling block in front of him. And I want to make sure that I'm prepared to be an edification. Love unto edification. And then not being a stumbling block. And I don't want to be a castaway after I've preached, be found a castaway. But it's not rules and regulations. It's not do's and don'ts. Well, you can't look this way and you can't wear that and you can't eat this. No, all things are lawful. I'm going to walk in love. I don't want to be a stumbling block to my brother. I want it to be profitable. I don't want to be under the power of anything, the flesh controlling me. So he says in verse 23, 1 Corinthians 10, 23, all things are lawful for me. But all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but they don't all edify. Compare all of those verses. Put all of those verses together. Is it expedient? Is it profitable? Does it edify? Are you under the power of it, or are you demonstrating power over it? Is it a weight that you should put down? Is it a stumbling block to someone else? These are things to consider. Now come back to Romans 14, and we see now further what he means when he says, nothing is unclean of itself. He says, I'm persuaded by the Lord Jesus Christ that there's nothing unclean of itself. You can wash up a mule and maybe make that mule look real pretty, so good that somebody might be fooled and think that's a racehorse. Maybe the novice and the unlearned might be fooled. But you take that mule all gussied up to the racetrack, and when the gate opens and the horn sounds, the trumpet blows, whatever it is they do, that's a mule. It's not the outward appearance, it's what's on the inside. Anyway, and so he says, I'm persuaded of the Lord Jesus Christ that it's not rules and regulations, it's not do's and don'ts, it's not what I do and what I don't do, the outward appearance. No, it's all lawful. Nothing's unclean of itself. But to him that esteemeth it to be unclean, to him it is. And if your brother is grieved with the meat, then you need to have the love of God. And let that be unto edification. Don't destroy him with your meat. Don't let your good be evil spoken of. You say it's good. Now, verse 17, this is a powerful scripture. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink. That means it's not rules and regulations. It's not how long your hair is, or how short it is, or how long your dress is. I mean, things ought to be decent, and we ought to have modest apparel and so on, but it's not rules and regulations. Amen. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink or rules and regulations. The kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Then he comes down to verse 21. It is good neither to eat flesh nor to drink wine or anything. If your brother stumbles or is offended or is made weak, that's flesh or meat that's offered to idols. Or you don't know. You don't know. That's the question they asked him. What if it's been offered to an idol? We don't know. Maybe this meat was offered to an idol and then they put it into the market to sell it. And I want to know its history. Where's this meat been? Before I eat it, I want to know if it's ever been offered a sacrifice before an idol, before they brought it to the market to make some money off of it. I want to know. Paul said it doesn't matter because the idol's nothing. The idol's nothing. God has reduced the idol and the devil behind the idol to nothing. It's nothing. But if it causes your brother to have a stumbling block, then he says, whether it's meat or wine or anything, it causes your brother to stumble or be offended or be made weak. Then he's saying it's not good to do that. Consider that. Consider it. Then verse 22, do you have faith? Can you do these things and maintain your fellowship with the Lord Jesus? That's the key. Can you still hear the sound? I'm staying with the theme because I heard early on tonight, hear the sound. And then I thought, well, we have to stay tuned up. We have to stay attuned. We have to stay sensitive, not get dull of hearing, stay close enough to hear it and stay sensitive to hear it, to hear the sound. Then I thought, that's part of the devil's game. Is to have people feel condemned. He wants to pull people into sin. The flesh is tempted because the flesh has desires. I'm in the flesh too. I know something about desires. Paul did too. He said, I keep under my body. So he must have known something about it. He had a body that had desires, or else why did he have to say, I have to keep it under? And the purpose isn't because I'm going to feel real bad. Now you will, and that's self-respect's important. And you don't need to kick yourself. I mean, that is important. I don't minimize that. I just don't think it's the most important. It's not the top of the list. It's in the list, but it's not the top of the list. The top of the list is edification for the others. The top of the list is being prepared for the benefit of other people, pleasing God, and being fully prepared unto every good work, not being a castaway, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 9. And so he's saying, do you have faith? That is, can you do what you're doing with faith toward God? In fellowship with him, you're walking in the light as he is in the light, and you don't have a problem at all with it, with all integrity, with all sincerity. You're not trying to fool yourself, lie to yourself in denial, because your flesh really does like it. And so you're figuring out a way. You're manipulating the scriptures to figure out a way to justify it so it's okay, because I really want to do it. Anybody know what I'm talking about? No, do you have faith? I mean, in your heart, that you're in fellowship. Well, you can have that. Even if your brother says it's wrong, well, you don't want them to be offended or weak or made weak or stumble. But if you have faith before God, have it to yourself before God. Now, this is a great verse here. This is a great verse. Verse 22, happy is he that condemns not himself in that thing which he allows. Somebody else may not allow it because they're weak in the faith. Now, I don't mean you're making an occasion to the flesh. I don't mean that you're justifying things because your flesh wants it and you're manipulating scripture to figure out a way to make it all right. I mean, sincerely, with all integrity, it's right. And Paul said that. He said, it's all lawful for me. But if it's not profitable, if it's not expedient, I'm not going to be brought under the power. It's not going to control me. Amen. But if you have faith toward God, and you're not condemning yourself, you're happy. You're happy. Be happy. Condemnation is never right. Now, the Holy Spirit does not condemn you. He convicts you. It's your own heart that condemns you. That's what 1 John chapter 3 says. If a man's heart condemns him not, it's not God, or it shouldn't be your brother or your sister that condemns you. And the Holy Spirit won't condemn you, but your heart will. And so listen to that. But if you're allowing it and you're not condemning yourself, then you're happy. But verse 23 says, if you're doubting, well, I'm wondering if this is right or not, then it's not. Well, I'm just wondering if this is wrong, then it is. I remember years ago, you know, this is the mentality that was in the church. Years ago, somebody came to a preacher, a pastor, and they asked this pastor, is it a sin to drink Dr. Pepper? And that pastor said, I don't know, but if you give it up, God will bless you. That's the mentality that was in the church. If you give it up, God will bless you. No. If you're wondering about it, then you need to get into the word and get into the spirit, not wonder. If you're wondering about it, then it will condemn you. But you need to get into the word and get into the spirit and settle it. Is it according to the word? Is it according to the spirit? And I don't want others to stumble or be made weak or so on, be offended. But if I see in the word, it's not controlling me and it's profitable. It's not a weight. If it's a weight, I need to lay it down, not hurting my testimony. I can have faith to myself, not condemn myself. Well, I'm happy. I'm happy. I'm happy. Happy. But if you doubt, then, this meat, you know, I don't know if it's offered to an idol or not. Well, then don't eat it. If it's not a faith, it's sin. Amen. Is that what it says? If it's not a faith, it's sin. Look at Colossians chapter 2. Where else did I have you turn? How many places are you holding? 1 Timothy 4. Yes, we want to get to that. Look at Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, verse 16, let no man therefore judge you in meat. Now, this isn't specifically talking about being a vegetarian. This isn't specifically talking about clean and unclean, but it could be. It could include that. But it also is including meat offered to idols. Whether or not it has been, we don't know. So they were asking that question. What about meat offered to idols? 1 Corinthians chapter 8. But there it still was the question, though, clean and unclean. That was still there in people's thoughts. Because the Old Testament, you know, called some things clean, some things unclean. And you can't eat this and that you can't. Well, you remember Peter had this vision. He saw a sheet let down from heaven and it had all manner of, creeping things and four-footed and so on and on and on. And the Lord said in the vision, "Rise, Peter, slay and eat." And Peter said, "Not so, Lord. Nothing common or unclean has ever entered into my mouth." And the Lord said to him, "Don't call common or unclean what the Lord has cleansed." Don't call common what the Lord has cleansed. Now, he's referring to the Gentiles because the Jews had no dealings with the Gentiles. And Jesus, you know, is talking to Peter about this. And Cornelius is praying and has seen in a vision. "Go inquire in the city of Joppa for one who lodgeth in Simon the Tanner's," you know, for Peter. And Peter has had this experience with this sheet that's let down from heaven. Don't call common what the Lord has cleansed. Now, why would he use this to demonstrate that the Gentiles are no longer common if it weren't also true of the beast, the food? Something changed when Jesus was raised from the dead. Many things changed. Many things changed. Well, diet changed. Worship changed. The heart of man changed. Prayer changed. Jesus said, "In that day, you'll ask me nothing. Hitherto, you've not asked in my name. In that day, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he'll give it you. In that day." Isn't that what he said in John 16:23? John 16:23, Jesus said, "In that day, you'll ask me nothing. Whatever you ask the Father in my name, he'll give it you. Hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. Ask and you'll receive, that your joy may be full." So he's saying prayer is going to change. You won't pray the same way. That after the day of resurrection, you won't pray the same way. He said worship will change. He told the woman at the well of Samaria, he said, "You worship, you know not what. Salvation is of the Jews. But the hour it cometh, and now is, that the true worshipers will worship in spirit and in truth." Worship is about to change. The day of resurrection, worship changed. The heart of man changed. Prayer changed. Diet changed. The Gentiles now can come in. He's broken down the middle wall of partition. And now there's neither Jew nor Greek. Male nor female, bond nor free. In heaven, there's neither marrying nor giving in marriage. Not even male or female. They asked Jesus, who's she going to be married to? Had seven husbands. Jesus said, "You do err, not knowing the scriptures." We got people today erring because they don't know the scriptures. In heaven, there'll be neither marrying nor giving in marriage. You'll be as the angels. You won't be an angel, but you'll be as. Same way. They're not looking for a spouse in heaven. Angels, who you going to marry? Amen. No, things changed when he was raised from the dead. And so the Gentiles can come in, and Peter's the one God's dealing with because he has a problem with it. And so Cornelius sends three men to Joppa. Peter gets three to go with him back to Cornelius. Because remember, the Spirit said to him, "Three men seek thee, rise, go with them, doubting nothing." Three men seek thee, rise, go with them, doubting nothing. Cornelius sent three. And while the three are there, getting ready to knock on the door, the Holy Ghost said to Peter, "Three men are looking for you. Now get up and go with them and don't even ask any questions. Just go." And Peter got three to go with him. You've got three and one, including Peter, makes seven. Those are good numbers.
And he goes back and he preaches in Acts chapter 10, around verse 44. He said, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. You're getting a hold of it, aren't you? I perceive. I guess you do. You just had quite an experience with that vision. I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. Well, he's preaching, and while he's preaching, the Holy Ghost falls. The Holy Ghost fell on those who heard the word, the Gentiles. And they spoke with other tongues, and the people that came with Peter were sort of surprised at that. And Peter said, you need to baptize them, because haven't they received the same Holy Ghost as we? They heard them speak with tongues. They didn't want to baptize them. Peter had to get strong. He said, I command you to baptize them in the name of Jesus. Well, he wasn't commanding how, he was commanding who. It's not a formula anyway, it's faith. They were baptized in the name of Jesus, but Peter was commanding who? Because they didn't want to. These Jews did not want to baptize these Gentiles. Are you kidding me? They're Gentiles. The Jews have no dealings with the Gentiles. And the Lord had to get a little bit strong with Peter. Rise, Peter, slay and eat. Well, now, Peter didn't just immediately say, okay, Lord. No, his first response was, not so. I'll not do it. So here's the clean and the unclean. Now, it's referring to the Gentiles, but God also is using this to demonstrate diet has changed. So he's asking the question, or he's presenting the exhortation in Colossians 2:16. Don't let anybody judge you in meat. Has it been offered to idols? Is it clean or unclean? Well, no. Not in meat, not in drink, not in respect of a holy day, the Sabbath. Is it Saturday or Sunday? Don't let anybody judge you. We read that earlier in Romans 14. Be fully persuaded in your own mind. Amen. This kind of preaching ought to be just preached from every pulpit, because we've got people arguing and fighting small wars. And yet these Bible verses have been in the Bible the whole time. Amen. Or the new moon or the Sabbath. It's just a shadow of things to come. The body is Christ. We're the body of Christ. Quit fighting about these things. That's what Paul's exhorting. Well, people didn't get a hold of it. They're still fighting. Now he comes down to verse 21. Touch not, taste not, handle not. Rules and regulations. Touch not, taste not, handle not. Rules and regulations. All of this is going to perish with the using after the commandments and doctrines of men. Which things have indeed a show of wisdom and will worship. People are complying and they look holy. But he says in verse 1 of chapter 3, if you're risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Set your affection on things above. Verse 3, you're dead. Your life is hid with Christ in God. Then he gets into the real issue is the desires of your flesh. That's the real issue. Verse 5, mortify, therefore your members. That's the real issue. Now, 1 Timothy chapter 4. Now, the Spirit speaketh expressly, that is, with some emphasis, a degree of importance. It's strong on the inside of him. He's writing this to Timothy, but it's by the spirit of prophecy. Now, all scripture is given by inspiration. But this has some emphasis. He's writing this under the unction and by the unction of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Ghost is inspiring me, and I know it. I know it. There's some emphasis. The Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times... Well, I wonder if we're there. If we're not there, we're certainly closer than we've ever been. People say, well, are we in the last days? They've been saying that for 2,000 years. Well, if we're not, we're closer. And the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter time, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. where, see, the conscience is the voice of the spirit. You have three parts to you. You are spirit. You have a soul. You live in a body. The soul embodies the emotions and the will and the ability to decide and choose. It's your mind, your will, and your emotions. And then your body. The voice of the spirit is conscience. The voice of the soul is reason. The voice of the body is feeling. You know, some things by the spirit don't seem reasonable. You remember in the Old Testament that says, he that winneth souls is wise? Well, you couldn't be saved in the Old Testament. So that's not even the same as what people call soul winning today. It's reasoning with people to make the right choice. He that reasons with people and they are encouraged to make the right choice. But today in the New Testament, God wants us to be led by the Spirit in line with his word. The devil will fight you in the emotional realm and the physical realm, the sense realm. And he'll talk to your head and try to make things seem unreasonable when the Spirit spoke to your heart. Somebody say amen. Just because it seems reasonable or it seems unreasonable is not necessarily a sign of the direction of the Spirit. The voice of the soul is reason. Multitudes, Joel chapter 3 says, multitudes are in the valley of decision. Isaiah speaks of God talking to his people, come let us reason together. So we can go to God and we can reason things out. We need to make the right choices and we need to exhort one another daily while it's called today. But there are some things. Now, operating as a prophet and a teacher, sometimes that's difficult because the teacher wants everything to make sense. I like to make it as simple as I can. But then some things in the spirit realm don't make sense. And so you fight because you might feel on the inside, I say feel, but you know what I mean. It's not a physical thing, but we are sensed to be led a certain direction and to do a certain thing. And the mind says, that doesn't make sense. And so you don't want to do it because it doesn't make sense. The prophet and the teacher are fighting each other. One is being led of the spirit. The other is saying, that doesn't make sense. But God wants us to follow him, whether it makes sense or not, when you know it's him. But here, the conscience is not a good guide because it's been seared over. Where you can't even make the right decision spiritually because you've put up with something that's wrong so long to where it doesn't seem wrong anymore. That's why I say repent quick. Don't play with that. I don't understand Christians who put up with certain things. I mean, the longer I live and more mature and older I get spiritually, I find myself repenting more than I used to. And I like it that way. Want it to be that way. Want to stay sensitive, tender. Don't want to get to the place where I don't recognize it as being wrong. But in the last days, there are going to people, their conscience is seared just like it was with a hot iron. And they fall away. They depart. They give heed to seducing spirits, doctrines of devils, forbidding to marry. That's not important anymore. Commanding to abstain from meat, commanding, ordering you to. But it says God created this to be received with thanksgiving to those who believe and know the truth. Now look at verse 4, 1 Timothy 4:4, every creature of God is good. Nothing to be refused if it's received with thanksgiving. For it's sanctified by the word of God in prayer. It's set apart for the use of your body, nourishment and so on. Not only by prayer, but by the word of God in prayer. That's why it's good to pray a prayer of faith over your food. Pray a prayer of faith over your food because that's what sanctifies it. Your faith in his word and that prayer. Well, very often when I pray over food, I just include that. You don't have to include that. You just need to do that because it is sanctified by this word, the word of God, and your faith in the word and your prayer. Then it says, if you put the brethren in remembrance of these things, then you're a good minister of Jesus Christ. Well, that's good. That's what I'm doing tonight. It's So if I put you in remembrance, it says I'm a good minister. Well, I want to be a good minister, nourished up in the words of faith and of good doctrine whereunto thou hast attained. Refuse profane and old wives' fables. Exercise thyself rather unto godliness. Bodily exercise profiteth little. It may profit, but it's not. It doesn't profit you spiritually. Now it says little, because God wants you to keep your body healthy. Some people go way too far. I mean, they're out there, and they bring God into it. God wants me to have a healthy body. He does. But He wants you to have a healthier spirit. He does. And that's what it says. Bodily exercise, by contrast, that doesn't mean do away with it. I'm going to sit and get fat and just turn to flab and just eat chocolate and watch TV. Bodily exercise profiteth, but it's little, comparatively speaking. Godliness is profitable unto all things. I need to watch my diet and I need to exercise. But that's not the priority. Are you hearing me? I mean, I'm pleased and proud and commended. You know, you brag on people where they're going to the gym, they're working out, and they're watching their diet, and they're losing weight, and they've gone from a size 16 down to a size 12, or a size 42 down to a size 36. You know, say, you're looking good. But that's not the priority. The priority is spiritual things. Godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. Amen. So these are the things that are important. Some of the things that are important to stay where you can hear the sound. Hear the sound, the call to assembly. Hear the sound, the call to arms. Hear the sound, the call to protection. Hear the sound, the call to the rock. There's an enemy. There's a threat. Hear the sound. Danger. The danger sound. To stand your ground. Be prepared. Hear the sound. Avoid that which causes one to be dull of hearing. Avoid that. Avoid that which causes one to be dull of hearing. Stay close in the fellowship of the Spirit of God, the Word of God, the saints of God. To hear the sound, to be fully prepared unto every good work. Amen. Is this all right tonight? I heard that just a little while. Hear the sound. I mean, I was playing something on the keyboard, and then it was like the sound from heaven can come this way. And it's a distinguishing sound. It has significance. You remember what Paul said to the Corinthians? 1 Corinthians 14:7. And even things without life giving sound, whether pipe or harp, except they give a distinction in the sounds, how shall it be known what is piped or harped? For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall be prepared? Who shall prepare himself to the battle? So the sound has a distinction, but we need to, and a significance, we need to hear it, recognize it. Understand it. Hear the sound. I believe the Lord wants to protect us, warn us, guard us, prepare us, equip us, and then send us. Here am I, Lord, send me. Here am I, send me. Here am I, Lord, send me. Well, are you prepared? Let's stay ready. Stay prepared. Amen.